Claims of Identity by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 20 of 27. Role of Humor in the Environment. Humor is a distinguishing characteristic in the environment. Humor helps ease emotional and physical isolation. It also helps convey important social messages. Humor is defined as a comic quality in a situation and must be distinguished from the genre of comedy in which the entirety of a work is meant to be humorous. This distinction is important because the ideas in the works treated by this essay are serious, although certain aspects which will be analyzed are delightfully lighthearted. More specifically, Edward Abbey's Desert Solitaire, Gary Snyder's Turtle Island, and Peter Matheson's The Snow Leopard each demonstrate how humor persuades the reader to see good, evil, and the environment from new perspectives by employing irony, hyperbole, and funny juxtapositions. However, each author is unique in the way each one uses humor to address relevant topics and themes. As a case in point, consider the dark humor of Edward Abbey. Dark humor means that Abbey exaggerates the grotesque in order to focus the reader's attention to a specific intention. One of the primary claims Abbey makes in Desert Solitaire is the absurdity of humanity's perceived domination of the earth. In his narrative nonfiction, Abbey calls into question the necessity of automobiles, the preoccupation of building roads in national parks, and tourist expectations of the wild. It is the darkness of Abbey's humor that intrigues the reader, and influences him or her to take account of the seriousness of Abbey's criticism regarding the erroneous proposition that humans can and should do as they please with the environment merely because they have the power to do so. The fierceness of Abbey's passion, however, is moderated by moments of calm reflection, such as when he kills a rabbit, presumably for no reason. One ironic quality of the slaying of the rabbit is that Abbey is employed as a park ranger in Arches National Monument in the dry desert of southern Utah. As a ranger, it would be Abbey's duty to preserve and conserve the wildlife that resides within his jurisdiction. But as Abbey explains, "I'm a scientist, not a sportsman, and we've got an important experiment underway here for which the rabbit has been volunteered." 41. By prefacing what follows with Abbey's tongue-in-cheek self-identification that he is a scientist, one who is ostensibly objective, he heightens the ironic turn of events, thereby amplifying the dramatic effect of his actions. Abbey explains that upon returning to his desert trailer in the park one day, "I see a young cottontail jump from the bush, scamper across the trail and freeze under a second bush. He huddles there, panting, ears back, one bright eye on me." 40. So far, the reader's impression of the rabbit is positive, perhaps conjuring a compassionate feeling for the rabbit's timidity, cute bunny-like features, and fear of strange people. If Abbey were describing a jackrabbit, the reader's affectation might be more negative, because jackrabbits, unlike cottontail rabbits, are ugly and weird-looking. Nevertheless, Abbey continues, animals have no sense of sportsmanship. Some, like the mountain lion, are vicious. Others, like the rabbit, run away, which is cowardly. 41. Based on this knowledge, the reader would assume that Abbey must be about to develop some important observation, which ultimately magnifies the dramatic tension of the situation. As Abbey finally concludes, "I rear back and throw the stone with all I've got straight at his furry head. He crumples, there's the usual exchange of blood, etc., a brief spasm, and then no more." 41. This is merely shocking to the reader, but certainly not humorous. It's what Abbey says next that's funny: "The wicked rabbit is dead." 41. The point Abbey makes from this supposedly scientific experiment is that the relationship between human and animal is a binary in the same way that both life and death, good and evil, are binaries. The dryness and darkness of Abbey's humor is entirely dependent on the one word, wicked. As a scientist, or a park ranger, Abbey should know better than to come to absolute moral conclusions about what is wicked and what isn't. What right does Abbey have to victimize an innocent creature? The reader's initial conclusion might be that the truly wicked one is Abbey, not the cowardly rabbit. As a result, the profound irony of the situation is clearly portrayed. Yet, The real portent of Abbey's experiment is to illustrate the stupidity of moral conclusions based solely upon an individual's power, and the collective disparity of power between humans and the environment. The object of Abbey's cruel experiment, a cuddly bunny, in some readers' imaginations, enhances Abbey's intentional use of the word wicked, making it seem all the more outlandish and absurd. The rabbit is merely the victim of human malevolence. However, the hidden message that Abbey sends by this brief narrative has far wider implications than to be relegated to an isolated incident. In fact, this message colors the entirety of Desert Solitaire. It explains, using humor, much of Abbey's otherwise ardent views about the flimsy pretext of power which humans use to justify their environmental pillaging. On the subject of dams, for instance, Abbey compares the consequences of the Boulder Dam on Glen Canyon to be like the Taj Mahal or Chartres Cathedral buried in mud until only the spires remain visible, 189. Whenever animals are mentioned again, as he does when he describes the moon-eyed horse in the desert, the reader cannot help but recall Abbey's cruelty, but also realize the paradoxical sensitivity he feels for animals. The dark humor of the situation of the rabbit amplifies the grotesque for dramatic effect, demonstrating that, really, Abbey is making a martyr of the rabbit. The rabbit died because of the sins of all humanity. In this regard, Abbey's impromptu slaying of the rabbit shows the reader how stupid the presumption is that humans are greater than nature, merely because humans have the power to pollute and exterminate entire ecosystems such as the one that existed in Glen Canyon. One realizes from pondering further on Abbey's example of the rabbit that human justifications are as warrantless as Abbey's own rabbit execution. By using humor, Abbey distances the reader from the subject of his or her own environmental impact by inviting him or her to be rightfully appalled by animal cruelty, probably without realizing that the morality at work behind being appalled also demands that the reader reevaluate his or her own values regarding human encroachment into the wild. Gary Snyder, on the other hand, uses humor in a more sensitive and less demanding manner. Snyder's humor has a softer edge that ruminates on the silliness of conventional attitudes about the right way to live, providing examples about dress, family, bathing, and the food chain to demonstrate his argument. Within his humor, the situational elements of his characters and images are often juxtaposed against the reader's, perhaps, preconceptions of such things. The result, although in poetry, and not in narrative nonfiction like the other authors, is a useful tool for changing human perspectives about the environment. Because Snyder uses a somewhat different rhetorical approach than Abbey, the reader also comes away with a different perspective about the environment than one would get from reading Desert Solitaire. Abbey is didactic, Snyder is compassionate. Although humor is not a dominant tone in many of his poems, The Call of the Wild is a good example of when it is. Like much of Snyder's Turtle Island, The Call of the Wild is a passionate examination of the role humans play in nature in an increasingly unnatural world. This poem begins with a coyote. The symbolism of the coyote is developed throughout the poem. In the beginning, the canine is described as singing. In the back meadow, but while the animal is not near any homes, hence in the back meadow, its singing is dangerous enough to warrant the government/trapper/who uses iron leg traps, 21, 2-3, 9-11. The image of iron leg traps presented by Snyder comments on the brutality of government policies, which in turn reflects unnecessarily negative public attitudes about the coyote. Suddenly, the reader is confronted with a very strange disparity between the perceived beauty of the coyote, singing, with its perceived dangerousness reflected by the stark iron leg traps. So far, like the death of the rabbit championed by Abbey, the situation Snyder presents does not seem very humorous, yet it becomes humorous. The traps are preceded by the introduction of a generalized individual who is a Catholic and a native Californian, 21, 5-6. Neither one of these characteristics are themselves bad, but the same individual is also a heavy old man who ranched and mined and logged, 21, 1, 4. In this regard, Snyder suggests that the old man might be heavy because he has only taken from the earth, never giving with love. Ranching, mining, and logging each suggest the idea of plundering, rather than caring for the earth. The word heavy also connotes the idea of burden. Hence, the profession of the old man has burdened him, and victimized the coyote. The humor of Snyder's poem begins to take effect when he criticizes those that might initially be considered Snyder's allies, and enemies of the heavy old man. In fact, Snyder exposes the ex-acid heads from the cities to be actually no better and perhaps much worse, 21, 16. This is because they continue similarly destructive environmental policies which Snyder blames the heavy old man for. Although these ex-acid heads, elsewhere identified yuppies, externally appear to be friends of the environment, for example, by no longer eating meat, dreaming of India, and sleeping in oil-heated geodesic domes, Snyder considers these same external attributes to be, like warts. In the woods, 21, 26-27. The consonance of warts and woods adds to the humor of Snyder's observation, thereby lightening through the environmental use of humor his sure condemnation. What is also humorous about the comparison between the heavy old man and the yuppies is their ironic similarity. This comparison shows that irony is a crucial dramatic element in the construction of humor in narrative nonfiction. There would be no humor and no dramatic effect in this poem if Snyder merely proceeded with an enemy's list of the environment, and then proceeded to attack them mercilessly. Rather, by targeting the ex-acid heads, in a way, Snyder targets his own audience as a poet, which is ever more humorous because it draws on Snyder's own personal association with the Beats and the hippies. Furthermore, Snyder apparently reserves more contempt for the yuppies because, in comparison, at least the heavy old man in the beginning of the poem is competent enough to have ranched, mined, and logged. At least heavy old man has some skills that are evidence of a more direct connection to the earth, even if it is destructive. The skills of ranching, mining, and logging could possibly be used for good one day, if they are moderated and applied judiciously. Yuppies, on the other hand, at least in this poem, have no real skills. Yuppies are described, not only as moronic, but in fact fearful of the same nature they pretend to identify with. This is made apparent in the lines. And the coyote singing is shut away. For they fear the call of the wild. 22, 28-32. The contradiction between singing and what would inspire fear to the yuppies is so extreme that, complicated with irony, Snyder is once again humorous. Although there is nothing so dark about Snyder's observations as Abby's, both authors drive home the similar message that humans must reassess their preconceptions of nature and become caretakers rather than exterminators of it. However, Snyder, unlike Abby, can be more overtly critical while still seeming compassionate. The association of the call of the wild and the singing of the coyote, which is intentionally capitalized as a proper noun, further develops the primacy of the coyote as a symbol of an environment that is a friend to humans, yet is treated like an enemy or a tool by many. This symbolic association is partly affected by the poem's title that alludes to Jack London's novella The Call of the Wild, which tells the story of Buck, a sensitive and helpful husky that proves to be truly man's best friend. The nature of Snyder's fusing of coyote to the allusion of Buck, a domesticated dog, consequently allows Snyder to humorously make fun of the severe overreactions of both the heavy old man and the yuppies concerning a canine which is despised and feared, apparently for no reason, and even though the coyote is a good singer. To further Snyder's claim about the stupidity of the yuppies, he adds that they sold their virgin cedar trees to a logger who told them trees are full of bugs, 22, 33, 37. This example begs the question about whom should really be cut down, the trees or the yuppies. But the author's playful word choice using bugs instead of insects or termites reveals that he does have a softer side and is being more playful than wrathful, although his message is serious. The entity of the government, however, causes more grave troubles than those of merely trapping coyotes. The relentless bombing of Vietnam and the Vietnamese, the widespread use of napalm, and the looping of deer intestines on rocks are some of the most severe images of environmental destruction Snyder employs in Turtle Island. But Snyder's humor softens the blow of what might otherwise have become a more hostile overtone. He achieves this by pairing images of extreme power with strange, impotent images of bouffant hairdos. Putting nail polish on the gunship cannon buttons, 22, 43 to 45. The pairing of nail polish with cannon buttons is an unusual and humorous juxtaposition. The pairing makes war seem absurd as its beauty agents are involved. Likewise, the far deadlier bomber planes in the poem are described as all these Americans up in special cities in the sky. Dumping poisons and explosives, which is a somewhat humorous reference, perhaps, to Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travels when Gulliver visits the sky city of Laputa and its sophisticated residents, Laputa meaning the whore in Spanish, 23, 59-60. This would suggest that intellectual pursuits unallied with moral causes is dishonoring. Peter Matheson's The Snow Leopard also uses humor as a rhetorical device. Matheson, though, contrary to Snyder, utilizes an especially dry and situational humor to convey his important ideas, which are more about the spiritual environment of humanity than the physical one, although they are both interconnected. Matheson uses two main examples of this, which are prefaced by the context of his journey to the Himalayas of Nepal, which he explains is probably an unconscious attempt to grieve over his wife's recent death. Hence, Matheson is undergoing a process of emotional purging, transition, and resurrection. Like the situation of Abby's martyred rabbit and Snyder's martyred coyote, the graveness of death reveals nothing inherently humorous. Yet, Matheson's rare instances of humor are altogether more powerful and rewarding to the reader as a result of the background of loss that he makes well known to the reader. The first great situational irony is that when Matheson finally reaches Dalpo, the distantly removed sanctuary of Tibetan monks and monasteries, the monasteries are closed and the monks away for the winter. This is an unexpected turn of events, especially after the reader has followed Matheson up and down, down and up, up and down, and so forth, in chapter upon chapter of hiking narratives. In this process, the reader becomes acquainted with Matheson's spiritual views, personal history, and also much about the different sects of Buddhism, Tibetan culture, and the rigors of awesome hiking. The reader feels no strong inclination to laugh when Matheson realizes that the monasteries are closed. Rather, one is able to make a connection to the fundamental Buddhist tenet of non-attachment, realizing that Matheson's journey was never really concerned with the monasteries, or his companion, G.S.'s search for blue sheep. As previously stated, the author's motives are very much centered on his coping with grief, as opposed to a conventional tourist's desire to see the sights. More importantly, the humorous foil of Matheson's long and arduous journey and the situation of the monasteries being closed helps the reader understand what Matheson previously writes concerning the Zen expression "kill the Buddha." 35. The idea of killing the Buddha is a little humorous for the same reason as the closure of the monasteries is a little humorous. One would assume that a person devoted to the Buddha's golden words would least desire to kill the Buddha, but as Matheson explains, these golden words may get in the way of ultimate perception, 35. This indicates that Matheson's true motive for his journey to Nepal, although he admits that he may not have understood it at the time, is to reassess his state of mind. Likewise, the other instances of humor in The Snow Leopard tend to be situational ironies. These humorous situations also tend to be descriptions of moments of unlikely spiritual realization. The second, and most important, use of humor in The Snow Leopard is a hyperbolic paradox. It is more humorous than the closure of the monasteries because the tension involving this second incident has been growing since the early October section of the narrative. It takes place when in October Matheson rested for the night in Rohajayon, a small, dirty village where one enters the Dark Ages, 133. That night the author was denied a most basic of human needs, sleep. He explains, "I lie sleepless, shouting hopelessly, as the exalted dog in the house above, crazed by the pale tents in the moonlight, barks unceasingly from midnight until dawn, without the smallest loss of tone or volume, 134. For anyone who has ever encountered such ill-mannered dogs, he or she can certainly identify with Matheson's plight, perhaps even evincing a slight chuckle at the utter truth behind his claim, or perhaps sympathizing with the utter hatred one might feel toward that animal. Contrary to Snyder's singing coyote, an innocent creature of the wild, this dog from Rohajayon might actually deserve the use of iron leg traps. However, Matheson will later avenge himself against the dog on his return trip from Dalpo. As he then describes, the mad dog of Rohajayon, chained outside, barked all night in vain, for I was too tired to be bothered by his uproar. Only in the early night, when he first woke me, did I go out and threaten him with my stick. This incensed him to the gargling point, he fairly tore his chain out of the wall. Carried away by drunkenness and mirth, I pissed on him, thereby wreaking my revenge for that nightmarish October night as well as this one. 296. This example is undoubtedly the most humorous aspect of the snow leopard, but this humor is buried in the full discourse of Buddhism and self-realization earlier discussed in the author's narrative. It is a funny juxtaposition of high desires and low needs, like a pig wearing lipstick. In a limited sense, the author's behavior is pathetic because he mistreats an animal that lacks the ability to know any better than to bark all night. The animal also cannot defend itself properly. In that regard, the dog is an innocent victim, although an annoying one. Furthermore, the author could be rebuked for not practicing the spiritual values he claims to believe in. However, in a broader sense, the author's final act of urinating on an evil dog symbolizes the author's overcoming of grief and an acceptance of both what is good and evil in life. It is a variant of the wicked rabbit depicted by Edward Abbey. The reader also cannot help but have the impression that the dog deserved it. Like killing the Buddha, Matheson acts outside the constraints of meaningless rules by accepting and acting on his innermost, and most human desire, to do what one wants to do. The utter senselessness and depravity of Matheson's one bad deed actually restores the author to a sense of power and agency, which are indeed human feelings, but not always inherently evil ones. Also, the grief the author feels during his pilgrimage has tended to deny these feelings of power and agency. The author's reprisal against the dog is therefore an act of healing. Matheson's action against the canine could be construed as a declaration of being, of isness, symbolized by the Buddha's gesture of touching the earth at the moment of enlightenment. It is. It exists. 104. Rather than denying himself the justice he deserves, the author is able to accept, and, in fact, relish in the simple, and, yes, pathetic display of his own power against a chained, snarling beast. Matheson's actions are also not so uncharacteristic of the environment in which he finds himself. For example, when in Tarakot, he says, "I follow the custom of the town, standing on the roof edge and urinating into the mud street, in daybreak light." This shows that the needs and desires of the human body are generally understood by the populace, 121. The solution and relief of Matheson's existential angst and resentment about the dog even relates to the koan his Zen Rashi imparts to him before he departs on his Himalayan sojourn. A koan is a Zen paradox, not to be solved by intellect, that may bring about a sudden dissolution of logical thought and clear the way for direct seeing into the heart of existence, 130. Hence, logic, like a certain cliff the author must pass in the narrative, gets people killed, to clutch, 129. By accepting the isness of his understandable annoyance at an irritating and mean dog, the author transcends his previous question of who is this ever-present I that is not me. 136. The nature of his existence is now known to him. This shows that the author is merely balancing negative forces with positive ones through a humorous episode. In this way, one solution to the special koan his Zen Rashi gave him, which was "all the peaks are covered with snow, why is this one bare," could be that a snow-covered peak is a barren peak, 130. This solution exposes both the true nature of barrenness and the true nature of snow. They are the same, the isness is united. Hence, the author's action against the wicked dog, like Abby's evil rabbit, is merely the fulfillment of the balance of cosmic principles, positive, yang, and negative, yin, as taught in the ancient Book of Changes, the I Ching, 165. The humorous episode of the dog also applies to tantric spirituality the author elsewhere discusses, basically amounting to the concept that all thoughts and acts, including the sex energies, are channeled into spiritual growth, with the transcendence of all opposites the goal, so long as a detached perspective is retained, 165. By accepting the pleasure of the author's conduct toward the dog, and then moving on without clutching onto feelings of guilt or prideful boasting, the author advances both the reader and himself along spiritual paths through his use of a situational, contextual, corporeal, and intellectual humor heightened by irony, paradox, and hyperbolic surprise. Humor helps soothe human fear and misunderstanding. Humor makes a dry subject more lifelike. Humor is a rhetorical strategy for favorably influencing popular conceptions of the environment. Like Edward Abbey with his martyred rabbit, which died because of the sins of all humanity, like Gary Snyder's coyote martyred by the ignorance of old men and yuppies, like Peter Matheson's mean dog that furthers humanity on its spiritual quest, the use of humor in the environment has shown itself to be as important a rhetorical device as any other. Humor is an application of pathos, based on an appeal to otherwise unexposed emotions. It helps the author present new and interesting ideas to the readers of, in this case, narrative nonfiction. Work cited. Abbey, Edward. Desert Solitaire, A Season in the Wilderness. New York, Ballantine Books, 1971. Print. Matheson, Peter. The Snow Leopard. New York, Penguin Books, 1996. Print. Snyder, Gary. Turtle Island. New York, New Directions Books, 1975. Print.